Hello everyone. Today we will see how we can create an Azure SQL database and an Azure SQL server using the Azure portal. Let's start. First, we need to go to the Azure portal. For that, enter portal.azure.com in the address bar. And if you press enter, it will take you to the portal. If you're not logged in, it will take you to the login page and then you can go to the portal. In the search bar, you need to search SQL Server. We will be creating the SQL Server first, but what you can do is you can also directly go to the SQL database and then within the database you can create a server. I'll show you that within a few seconds, but first we will create a server. Let's go to SQL Servers and here click on Create SQL Server. Subscription, our subscription is automatically selected as your subscription one. If you have more than one subscription, you can select from this dropdown. Same with the resource group. If you have more than one resource group in your subscription, you can select that here, or you can create a new resource group from here also. Server name. Now, remember that the server name needs to be globally unique. Globally unique means that no one in the world should have the SQL server with the same name. So we will follow the naming practice of SQL hyphen, and now we will enter a unique name. So let's make it test deployment. Will this work? Okay, yeah, this is unique. Location, we will keep East US. And here you will see there are three authentication methods. So let me explain all the three to you. Use only Azure Active Directory authentication. It means you will use your Microsoft account username and password for the authentication. Use SQL authentication. The third option means you will create a username and password specifically for your SQL server, and then you will use them for logging into SQL server. The third method is use both. So here you will create your SQL credentials also, and you can use your Microsoft credentials also. I usually prefer to just keep it simple and use SQL authentication. Here you need to create your username. Let's enter something very random. And let's enter something very random password also. Let's enter the password here again, and the passwords match. That's good. Then you can click on this button, review plus create. Here you can see that creating a SQL database server, creating the server does not incur any charge. Creating the database incurs the charge that we'll see going forward. And here you can just see that, okay, subscription is this. So this is basically the summary of what we have done until now that you can see, and click on create. Once you click on create, it will do some validations. And then you will see a notification here that, okay, the deployment has initialized. Now it is submitting, and this screen, this is the standard screen whenever you create a new resource on the Azure portal. It will show you the screen where you can monitor the deployment, or you can click on this notification bar also. You see a small bar going on here. So this shows that, okay, there is something going on. If you click on this notification, you will be able to see the details of that. Okay, the deployment is in progress. All right, our deployment is complete. Now we can go to our resource by directly clicking on this button, go to resource, or this button, go to resource. So let me show you. You are seeing a lot of information on this screen and you may not understand everything. Please don't worry. I will try to explain all the stuff in my further videos, but for the purpose of this video, I just want to stick to the basics. So now you are into your SQL Server resource, and let's say you are on your portal and now you want to go back to your SQL Server resource. What you can do is again, go to the global search bar. Click on SQL Servers, or again search for SQL Servers here, click here, and you will see your resource here. You can click on this and voila, you are on your screen. You can minimize the stuff from here and you are seeing the bigger version of this. So yeah, these are some ways you can navigate back to your SQL Server. After creating the SQL Server, our next step is now to create an actual SQL database. For that, again, go to the global search bar and enter SQL database. Click on this service, SQL databases. Nothing you will show up here because we have not created a database. Click on this create SQL database button. And the starting stuff will be pretty similar because Azure tries to keep things as similar as possible across different services. So we'll need to select our resource group. Database name. Now, database name need not be globally unique, but it should be unique within the server. So what happens is, what we just created was a SQL server, and within a SQL server, you can create as many SQL databases as you want. So we'll be creating one. And the unique criteria is, within one SQL server, all the databases name should be unique. So the naming convention for database is SQL DB hyphen. Now we will just call it test DB. And you see this dropdown here, we need to select our server. Now you will see that, okay, no available items. So this happens often. When you create a SQL server in Azure, it might take some minutes to show up in your SQL database screen. So the best scenario or the best action to do in this situation is just to wait for 10 to 15 minutes and your SQL server will show up in this screen. So I'll be pausing the video here for a few minutes and I'll resume from here in 5 to 10 minutes. All right, I came back to this screen after a few minutes. And as you can see that in my server, now we can see the server that we created, SQL hyphen test deployment. Let's enter the database name again, SQL DB hyphen test DB. Workload environment, development, production, it doesn't make much of a difference, but you can keep production if you're going to use it for, you know, in your daily use. And if you're just doing some testing, you can keep development. Doesn't make much of a difference. Now, this is very important. What you see here, compute plus storage, general purpose. Why this is very important? Because our cost will be determined from this. So if I just scroll a bit down here, you will see, you are seeing in INR, that is the Indian currency, that 30,000 INR. Currently, what I have selected here is general purpose database. This is a bit, you know, when you have some heavy purpose or some heavy load on your database, this machine you should choose in that scenario, general purpose. We don't want to incur 30,000 per month. So what we'll do, we'll go to configure database and we'll choose a smaller database. Not just smaller, a very small. So this basic for less demanding workloads, or you can choose standard budget friendly also. So let me show you this. When I choose basic, you will see that my cost has been reduced from 30,000 to 384 rupees. Basically just 1%, around 1% of what it was earlier. Or you can use standard also, budget friendly, which would be around 1150 INR. For my daily use databases, I usually prefer this standard budget friendly. And for some testing videos, I just use this basic. And here you can choose the data size in GBs for your database. Select apply. Now, if we scroll down here, you will see that my cost has been reduced to 384. Okay, before moving ahead, let me show you one more thing, configure database. So if you go to standard budget friendly, here you can increase your DTUs. Think of DTUs as a very simple unit, which includes the cores and RAM and everything. So let's say the standard default configuration is 10 DTUs. But let's say you want to increase the configuration of your database. You want to run more heavy workloads on this. So you can increase your DTUs and think of it like now you have more RAM and more cores in your database. That's what you can think of it in simple terms. And each DTU has its own cost. So here you will see that your cost has increased to 11,500 INR. And if we just go back to the default, it is 1156 INR, because you will see cost per DTU is 115 INR. We'll select our basic back and click on apply. Now here, backup storage redundancy. There are three types of backup storages, and I have a link to show you because this works best if you see it in visual form. What is the meaning of these three? Locally redundant, zone redundant, and geo redundant. This is locally redundant. So you will see that we are in the primary region. In our scenario, our region is East US, right? Locally redundant means three copies of your database will be stored within the same region and within the same physical location in the same region. Zone redundant means your database will be backed up in three different zones within the same region. Same region, but three different availability zones, 1, 2, and 3. And this is the geo-redundant storage. So what this shows us is that our database will be kept backup in a different region also. For example, if East US goes down, your data will be backed up in West US also. So this is the most, you can say, robust, because even if the whole region fails, you will not lose your data. By default, Azure selects geo-redundant backup storage for us. Everything looks good. We'll click on Review plus Create. And then the Create. Like earlier, it will do some validation. And the screen which you saw while it created the SQL Server, the same screen you will see in a few seconds here, where it will show that, okay, deployment of SQL database is in progress. All right, the screen is here, deployment in progress. We'll wait for a few seconds here. The deployment is complete. Like earlier, we can directly go to our database by clicking on this button, go to resource. And here, like earlier, you will see a lot of options. We'll not go into each and everything. I want to keep this simple. And let me show you how you can navigate from the home page to your database. So in the global search bar, search for SQL databases, click on SQL databases. And here is the database that we created, SQL DB-TestDB. Click on this and you will see the same screen which we just saw. And you can minimize this here. So yeah, our database creation is complete. Before going ahead, I want to show you one more thing, which I forgot in the previous step. So while creating a SQL database, we created the SQL Server first. But what you can also do is you can click on this Create New button. Let's say you have not created a SQL Server earlier, or you don't want to use the already created SQL Server. So while creating the database, you can click on this Create New button, and it will take you to this Create SQL Database Server screen. Here you can create your server, click on OK, and it will take you back to the SQL Database screen. So yeah, this thing is also possible. Now let's go back to our SQL database. Okay, let's test our database now, shall we? So Azure gives you the capability to query your database within the web app. So let's click on this query editor. And here you can enter your username and the password. You will not be able to do this Active Directory authentication because we did not enable it while we created the server. Let's see what Azure shows us. If we try to do it, it will not allow us. It is loading and you see login failed. We will enter our password here, if I remember it correctly. Okay, now, all right. This is very important. I was going to cover it after a few minutes, but okay, let's discuss this now. What this error is showing us is that our database is not configured for public access. An instance specific error occurred. Connection was denied since deny public network access is set to yes. Whenever you create a SQL database in Azure, by default, Azure disables the public access of the database. You will not be able to access it. So you have to go to the SQL server, not the database, but the server, and enable the access. Let's see how we can do that. Search for SQL servers already. We already have it here. Click on the SQL servers. I just control click on it so that it opens it a new tab. We will go to our SQL server. So in this navigation menu, we will go down. In the security tab, you will see this networking. This is the one-stop shop where you can configure all the access criteria of your SQL databases within this server. So public access right now, you see that it is disabled, but we want to enable it for selected networks. We'll click on this. And it automatically detects my current IP. So what I can do is I can click on this button, add your client IPv4 address. I will click on this. It automatically creates a rule for me, my IP address start and my IP address end, and click on save. Now, what it is showing me, it is showing me an error. Fail to update some rooms for SQL Server. Deny public endpoint enabled. Should have worked. Let me allow. Let me again click on save. All right. Successfully updated server exceptions. I did not click on this button. Allow Azure services and resources to access this server. Now it will work. Let's come back to our editor, query editor, and again click on OK. It is showing that my IP address access is still not allowed. Let's go back here and refresh this screen. Okay, the rule was not saved. We will click on this and we will click on save. All right, successfully update. Just to make sure that the rule is saved, let's again refresh this. And yes, we can see the rule is now saved. Again, go back to the query editor and click on OK. This time we are in the database. Here you can run any query. Let's click on this. No tables now. Let's create table test ID int and let's run it. I think I'm forgetting the syntax. Maybe I should remove the brackets and now run it. All right. Yes, I was right. I added the brackets with the data type, but we are not supposed to do that. Refresh the tables. You will see that, okay, dbo.test. We have created a table successfully with the ID column in this. So now you see, you can access this database and you can do pretty much anything what you do with a normal database. One more thing which I want to show you in this networking. So currently what we have done is I have just enabled access of my specific IP address, but in most of the scenarios, your IP address will not be static. So what I usually do, I do not recommend this, but I usually do is only for test purposes. When I create a production database, we always give access to specific IP address. But for test scenarios, what I usually do is you can enable access for all the IP addresses. How you do that is add a firewall rule, name it all IPs, and in the start IP enter 0.0.0.0 and end IP 255.255.255.255. I hope you already know this, that this is the range of IPv4 addresses. And now what you have done is you have given access from the start till the end. Everything in between now can access your SQL database. Click on OK, click on save. Now this rule is saved. Now your database can be accessed from all the IP addresses. So yeah, I think we have covered everything. Let me show you a few more items. Let's go to SQL databases. This is the screen of our SQL database. From here, you can get the server name. This is the complete address of your server name. This is the name of your database. You will have this SQL username and password that we created. So using these four items, you can create your connection string for your database, using which you will be able to access the database from any external script, that is Python, JavaScript, or you will be able to provide those connection string to your SQL Server Management Studio or your Azure Data Studio or any other tool that you may be using to access your databases. So yeah, if you need or if you have any other question in this, please let me know. Or if you have any other topic in your mind on which you want me to create a video, please let me know in the comments. Thank you.